I'm Roli, so I am back with part three of how I got in a wheelchair. If y'all haven't already, make sure y'all check out part one and part two. So before I start this video, let me just say, don't forget to subscribe and don't forget to like at the end of the video. And y'all can leave a comment because I don't bite. So let's just jump right on in, okay? So I left off leaving university. I was transported from university to Touro via ambulance. And when I got to Touro, I was greeted by an older nurse. I forgot her name, but she was really sweet, made me feel real comfortable. And she had like excellent bedside manners. Like she really took the ease off me, even though I was like eager to get to Touro because I knew that was like the next step to me regaining, you know, a little independence or whatnot, right? So the first day at Touro, I was admitted. They did my assessment and basically got me stable, right? And then the next day, I think is when I met the neurologist physician who was assigned to me, which is Dr. Glenn. I love Dr. Glenn. Has a real great sense of humor and great bedside manners. So that was the second day. And I think the third day I may have met my therapist, which was Rachel and April, like my favorite two people, right? And I still keep in touch with them to this day. Like I still see them, I still talk to them. They got me together, right? So I met them and my physical therapist basically was responsible for getting me in shape physically, basically, you know, like physically getting me in shape so that I'm able to push myself, do my transfers, you know, do my wheelies and things like that. And then my occupational therapist, she taught me more of how to dress myself, how to sit up, like how to brush my teeth, how to shower, how to use the bathroom, all of that. Because y'all have to keep in mind, like at university, I knew I was messed up, right? I knew I had a catheter in me because I couldn't get up to use the bathroom. But I had no idea that for the rest of my life, I would have to self-catheterize myself. So nobody told me that at university, which I didn't expect them to because that's a hospital. They're basically there to get you stable to move on to like the next recovery phase. So it wasn't until I got to Touro is when I found out all these additional things about myself, right? So I found out that I have no feeling or no function from waist down. So therefore, I can't like manually drain my bladder. So that's when I found out that I have to like self-catheterize myself. And I didn't take well to that. Like for the first week or two, maybe, I was not trying to learn how to catheterize myself because I just knew I couldn't do that. And let me tell y'all, ladies, I am 40. I think I was like 35 when my accident happened. I had no idea that women had two holes down there, okay? Okay? Two, all right? Not the vajayjay, but it's another one that the pee come out of. I didn't know that. And I ain't lying. I found all that out at therapy when I had to manually catheterize myself. So that was like mind-blowing, finding out all of these things on top of knowing that it's a possibility you'll never walk again. So it's like, damn, I'm dealing with this and then I come here. When is it gonna ease up, right? So, bam, started my therapy with my therapist. So let me just do a walkthrough of how it went every morning. So keep in mind, I had a blood clot. So I was taking blood thinners and it was called Coumadin. And with Coumadin, they basically have to test your blood to see where the level's at so they can know how much Coumadin to prescribe you. So every morning I would get woken up by a phlebotomist who would prick my finger to get my blood. Not prick. I think they used to draw blood. I don't quite remember. But every morning I had to go through that. That's how I was awakened by someone drawing my blood so that the doctor can know how much blood thinner to give me. So after that, breakfast would come. The menu was like awesome. It was almost like a 5-star hospital menu, right? So my breakfast would come, then I would take my meds, and then the therapist assistant would come through right after that to like stretch me out. Every morning I would get stretched out, and then after that it was my duty to get dressed and be ready for class. So every day we had to take a 1-hour educational class. And in educational classes, we were taught things like sex education, UTIs, cooking, getting around in the community. It's basically a classroom full of people sharing their experiences and talking about things that work best for them. Basically, you know, we all in the same situation. We just finding out that we have some sort of, you know, spinal cord injury or they had stroke patients, you know, so we basically just learning and interacting with each other. And so after the hour of educational class, that's when our therapy was start. And if I'm not mistaken, we had 2 hours of physical therapy and then 2 hours of occupational therapy every day. All right. Every day. Clockwork. It was no play. It was grind time. So after that therapy, the end of the day, we basically can like do what we want. We could have visited each other, you know, in the office, in the patient rooms. You know, Turo was real nice. You could have went outside. It was a lot of things we could have did. It was food places in the area we could have went to if we wanted to. So that was pretty cool. Another thing I liked about it was we took a kitchen. I forgot what it's called. It's a certain name for the class, but basically they taught us how to cook all over again, how to maneuver in the kitchen, what to do, what not to do. And you know, Miss Linda was the lady who taught the class. She would even like weekly, she would round us up and like take us to the movies. And I'm saying take us. I never wanted to go, but that was something that was offered, you know, outings and stuff. I don't know why I never wanted to, I guess, be a burden on somebody. And I knew I wasn't accepting it too well. And I knew I was going to need help with things. So I just kind of shied away from that. But that was something else that that they taught us over there at Turo. Like, I love Turo. I love all of the nurses, everybody, the whole staff, the whole ninth floor, the nurses, the doctors, the techs, to the lady that cleaned and made the beds. Like, I was friends with all of them. And until this day, I still go and visit them. Like, I love them. Like, they really got me together. And they'll be like, oh my God, Amelia, you look so good. You're doing so good. I'm so proud of you, this, that, and the other. So I need to get back up there and go and talk to him because I haven't seen him in a while. But so fast forwarding, I did like basically like 2 months, 1.5 months at Turo. So that was like a home to me. And at some point they would give us like weekend passes where we can like go home. We couldn't sleep home, but we can go home and like come back. Now, I'm not going to lie to y'all. The first time I went home, I didn't tell my family because I didn't want them to feel bad, but my house was like so foreign to me, I couldn't wait to get back to the hospital. And something, you know, like something wrong with that. This is my family. Like, I'm not supposed to feel like that when I come around them. I've been away from them for so long, but I guess I had just got used to being in the hospital and depending on the nurses. You know, because in this situation, you learning yourself, like anything can happen. I'm dealing with a blood clot. I don't know what it feel like to get, you know, when it break off and it becomes a pulmonary embolism, like you can get shortness of breath, like a lot of things can happen. So that really scared me because I ain't trying to die. So I don't want to be away from my nurses for too long because I'm afraid something going to happen and my family not going to know what to do. So in my mind, I'm like, I can't wait to get back to the hospital. Lord, I can't wait. But I can't tell my family that because it's my first time being home, like in months, right? So finally it was time to go back to the hospital, and it was the night that the jurors were announcing whether or not they were going to charge the Zimmerman for Trayvon Martin murder. So I just remember me trying to hurry up and kick ass back to the hospital because I didn't want to miss that. And I just was so relieved when I got back to the hospital. Now all that me can't wait to go home, this, that, and the other. And then when I do go home for a weekend pass, I'm like boo-hooing trying to get back to the hospital because I'm scared something going to happen and I'm not going to know what to do with my family, not going to know what to do. So that was kind of a sad moment for me because my house really felt foreign to me. I had to like ask them where stuff was and where this at. And you know, like, that's a bad feeling. It's real bad. And not only that, now you got to keep in mind, I was in a hospital for like 2.5-3 months before I was able to see the outside and see what the city looked like. You know, new buildings hadn't popped up. So me not driving, but coming from the hospital on my way home, all I could do is like look out the window and see everything that I missed out on from being gone. I said I wasn't gonna cry, y'all, so I'm gonna suck it up. But something like hit me, like, damn, like, you really about to be back to reality fucked up like this? Like, you sure you gonna be able to do this? Like, all that was playing in my head. while I was driving home. You know, I'm about to say locked up, but that's what it felt like. I had been locked up for so long when I finally got out. Reality hit me. And it was like, damn, Millie, this is the real world. You know, you can't be in a hospital forever. What you gonna do? You only got like a couple weeks left. So that was on my mind on top of me trying to hurry up and get back to the hospital. It was bad. I don't think I did no more home passes after that. Like, I'm sorry, y'all. I didn't mean to do this. But I don't think I did no more home passes. I was good, honestly, as long as my daughter was good. But it got to a point when she started asking me, Mama, when you coming home? You've been in the hospital too long. So that broke me down. Like, my counselor had to come in there and everything. Like, I was good as long as she was good. But the minute she said that to me, it took me out. So I arranged for her to come up to the hospital and spend some time with me. Child, sis was bored. She ain't stay up there a whole day. She checked out on me. Bad as she wanted me to come home, sis was out of there. But I knew she really wanted me home. Like, she didn't want to come there and have to sit there with me and see all that. And for the longest, even when I got out the hospital, I would not let her see the way I had to use the bathroom. I just didn't want her to see that because I felt like that was just going to break her up, you know? Bad enough she dealing with her mama's situation. And y'all don't even know, but she lost her daddy just 2 years prior to my accident. So I'm dealing with all this, right? And yeah, that's just what it was, y'all. She finally, you know, came around. I came around. I couldn't hide the way I do things forever from her. So, you know, she was okay with it. And she helped me, like, throughout my whole recovery process. From the time I was home up until now, it's just been me and Isis. Like, Isis do everything. I really wanted her to go to school to become a nurse because that's how good she is with, like, helping people. But, you know, you can't tell these kids what to do or what to be. But yeah, that's our story. So maybe I could do another video with like Isis and her telling y'all her feelings about the whole situation. But I think I came home. I think it was like right before July the 4th. I'm not sure, but I did do a whole 3 months between university and Touro. So when I came home, I was living in a townhouse, upstairs, downstairs. We had to move my room downstairs because obviously I couldn't get upstairs and I couldn't get into the bathroom because the bathroom was upstairs. I only had a half a bathroom downstairs. So I kid you not, I used to take a bath with bowls. I had two big red bowls and my mom used to help me. One used to be to like rinse myself and the other one would be to wash myself. And I did this for at least probably 6 months. I lived in that type of condition, like washing myself out of bowls. And it was just me, Isis, and my mom. I tried finding a big enough house. It was hard trying to find a fully accessible house. So I realized it was my best bet to just try to find a big enough house to make it work. You know what I'm saying? Like, it don't have to be perfect. As long as I can get in a bathroom, I can make some shit work, right? So it took me, like, I went through like two or three different houses. I found the people was playing games. They ended up not wanting to rent it to me once they found out that I needed to have a rent built on it, which I was going to pay for it myself and have everything done. But those fell through. So I'm like, you know what? I think God have a greater plan for me. I just need to sit back and stop worrying myself. And kid you not, the minute I did that, I got an agent. And she found me a house, which was in New Orleans East, the biggest house I've ever had. I was still on Section 8 at the time, but this was the biggest house I think I've ever had since I've been on Section 8, right? And let me tell y'all how perfect it was. It had a garage in the back, so I didn't have to worry about getting wet, you know, coming inside if it's raining outside. My daddy built me a deck that connected from the garage to my back patio so I can just roll right from there, from the garage to my back door and go inside. Tell me that wasn't perfect. That's what God had been like preparing me for. So I ended up being able to get a 3-bedroom house, which gave me way more room. It was an open floor plan, which means I didn't have to worry about maneuvering through doors. The front room was open to the kitchen. I had a fireplace. If anybody know me, y'all know how much I love fireplaces. And it also came with two full bathrooms. So I had my own bathroom in my room, and then Isis had her own bathroom. And so we lived in that house for about 3 years before my case was finalized. Yes, I had a case, and I'll probably be talking about that in part 4. So make sure y'all stay tuned, because I have a lot more to tell y'all. So yeah, stood there for about 3.5 years. We made it work. It was perfect for us at the time. I even tried to buy that house once it was time for me to leave, but it just didn't work out. So yeah, y'all, that's my story. That is my recovery part of the recovery. That's just me leaving out of Touro, which is a rehabilitation facility, inpatient rehabilitation facility. And that's where I stayed at during my rehabilitation process or time frame. I really love Touro. I would go there again if I had to. I absolutely love them. My therapists, Rachel and April, like I said, I still talk to them. I still do outpatient therapy. And guess what? They're still around. And April is still my therapist. And Rachel was still my therapist before she left and took on another job. But I still talk to her. So, hey, Rachel. Hey, April. I miss y'all. And I'm going to forever love y'all. Okay. And then Q is my current therapist right now. And I love Q. Q was actually working at Touro back when I did my inpatient. So honestly, I know all of the therapists, whether I work directly or indirectly, they know me and I know them. The nurses, like I said, the housekeeping ladies, man, we all joked in that thing, okay? Like, we had fun. And I'll never forget those people. Like, even though, some people may think of it as like bad memories, to me, it wasn't, because if it wasn't for those people, like, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. I wasn't going to outpatient therapy. Rachel convinced me to do it. Many times I was ready to check out of therapy, but, they were more like my therapist to me, too. Like, they were so, like, relatable. I can talk to them about anything. You know, they wasn't, like, judging me. They went beyond for me. I'm not even going to lie. And I am forever grateful for them. And Touro Infirmary, period. From the food menu to the bedside manners, the nurses all stuck together. You didn't hear one nurse nagging about what the other nurse didn't do. Like, it was none of that. It was a team. It was teamwork around there. And I really, 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 really appreciated that at the time I needed it. Like, so that's it, y'all. I ain't doing no edits on here. I did a straight through video, so I hope I did good. Don't judge me, because y'all know I'm new to YouTube. I want to say thank you to all my supporters, everybody that support me. Y'all got me here. Like, I would have never did this without my TikTok family. Like, TikTok is what started this, okay? They brought it out me. So shout out to y'all. And I know that most of y'all on YouTube, I'm sure y'all take up most of my subscribers. Like, y'all keep me going. I love y'all. I'm gonna keep y'all updated on my life. Anything change or anything, I'm so transparent. I'll be sure to keep y'all updated on my life. Because I have more to talk about, y'all. From Vandercloot to buying a house, to like running businesses and owning multiple real estates, to about to open up my very first business. Like, I have so much to talk to y'all about. So make sure y'all don't forget to subscribe, hit that like button, share your girl, and leave some questions and stuff in the comments. So that way I can give y'all some feedback, and maybe I can do like a Q&A on live, YouTube live. So y'all let me know what y'all think about all this. And yeah, stay tuned, y'all, because I have way more to come. Bye.